أن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Anyone who comes to Green Lane on Wednesday at this time going to be confronted with a lot of traffic, a lot of cars that are parked outside of the masjid, because on Wednesday there is a lot of activity going on in the masjid, walhamdulillah, of people teaching and educating the community and elevating the awareness about the deen. So we have a class in the basement, and we have a class up here. We have the madrasa for the youngsters, and we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to put that in the scales of the good deeds of the administration of Green Lane. Along those lines, I want to make mention of something that came to my attention about the presence of the Sheikh Abu Suhaib Ra'ahullahu Ta'ala, who's now teaching here at Green Lane. You, my students, you brothers who are here, maybe for the first time, those of you who are hearing me over the internet, and you're here in Birmingham, or you come to Birmingham for something and you're here on the day or the night that he's teaching, I advise you brothers and you sisters to take from Abu Suhaib Hafidhullahu Ta'ala. He's from the most knowledgeable people in this country, and Allah is his Hasib. And he has some unique characteristics that other people here who are giving dawah don't share with him. And from the premier, pinnacle, important characteristics is that he is an imtidad for us, an extension of the madrasa of Al-Imam Al-Albani Rahmatullahi Ta'ala Alayhi. Imam Al-Albani lived in Jordan, and Abu Suhaib is from Jordan, so he was blessed to have taken from the knowledge of the madrasa of Al-Imam Al-Albani. Also from the premier students of Al-Imam Al-Albani Rahmatullahi Alayhi. From them, our Sheikh, the Allama, the Muhaddith, Al-Athari, Abu al-Harith, Ali ibn Abdul Hamid ibn Hassan al-Halabi, Hafidhahullahu Ta'ala, and as well as Sheikh Abu Ubaidah, Mashhur Hassan al-Salman, Hafidhahullah, and other than those two. So I would like to repeat and I would like to reiterate and encourage all of you brothers and sisters to make it your business when he's giving his class, whenever he's teaching here, try to attend. I believe it's a power move in terms of the administration of Green Lane making the choice out of all of the people they could have brought here to deliver some lectures. They chose that individual. And we talked last week about the impermissibility of testing people with other people, and we warned about al-ghulu. And since I've been teaching you guys, giving dawah here, my call has always been, Ibrahim, Ismail, all of you guys, that we respect personalities. We respect personalities, but we hold on to principles. We hold on to principles. So we don't go overboard a Sheikh Abu Suhaib or other than him. A Shahid, if there were someone here in the country of the United Kingdom, Britain, who I would have said, if you want to test people, then test him by Abu Suhaib. But I can hey-hat, hey-hat. I'm not gonna say something like that. Because as I mentioned to you, brothers and sisters, in that last class, when it comes to the imtihanu nas, testing people with other people, we're going to test them with rumuz, symbols of the sunnah, high personalities. Not the personalities that any Amr, Bakr, and Zaid brings up. If you want to test the people of Canada, then test them with Troy. If you want to test the people of the UK, then test them with SP. If you want to test the people in Newark, New Jersey, then test them with Masjid al-Rahmah. That's a joke and it's insanity. If I were to say to the people, you want to test people here in the UK, then test them with Abu Suhaib. But I'm not going to say that. I'm going to say, as I mentioned to you, what the Sheikh and the Muhaddith of Al-Madinah said, Sheikh Abdul Muhsin Al-Abbad, Rahmatullahi alayhi, wa radiyallahu anhu, wa hafidhahu Allah ta'ala, wa saddadahu Allah. Sheikh Abdul Muhsin is from the kibar al-ulama for this ummah today. And he took the position, we shouldn't test people because he knows about the fitna and the drama that it has created. He said, we shouldn't do this. He said, and if we were to do it, then we should do it with the likes of a Sheikh Ibn Baz, rahmatullahi alayhi. Not the likes of everybody who I like or who he likes or who he likes. People who, again, as I mentioned, don't really have a lot of knowledge of al-Islam, have some knowledge. So I want to encourage you, brothers, to hold on to him. And don't just attend his class and sit there and listen. But the issues that you have, the questions that you have, prepare those questions and hold him and ask him about your issues. Don't overwhelm him. Don't overwhelm him, but it's a golden opportunity. After that, inshallah, azza wa jal, our nasiha to you brothers today and you sisters today is not going to be from the book, Ash-Shama'il, but it's going to be about another issue altogether. And that is the issue of the importance of beautifying your prayer. And a person can beautify his prayer by doing many, many things. The authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Inna Allaha ahaqqu an yutazayyana lahu." Allah has the most right that you beautify yourself for him. So if you want to go to get a job, if you go to the family of the girl who you want to marry, if you go to a walima, to an aqiqah, to a nikah, you're going to represent, and you're going to go in your nice clothes on the day of al-Jum'ah. You're going to represent because Allah has more right than anybody else that you beautify yourself. Allah mentioned, Ya Bani Adam, khudu zinatakum inda kulli masjidin. O son of Adam, wear your beautiful clothes when you go to the masjid. This ayat is actually talking about cover up your awra. That's what the ayat is really talking about. But nonetheless, the general message of the ayat implies, and it could be understood, that you should wear nice things when you come to the prayer. So there are many things that you can do to beautify your salat. And from the things that beautifies a person's salat is taking the sutra. I see some people in the audience I've never seen before. I was told that we have some new Muslims here as well. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about the prayer, "Inna awwal ma yuhasabu bihi al-'abdu min a'malihi yawm al-qiyamah as-salat." Very first thing that Allah is going to ask you about yawm al-qiyamah is your prayer. So it goes to show the importance of your prayer. You have to read about it. You have to learn about it. You have to get a book, and you have to get around people. And we have to learn continuously about what to do in the prayer and what not to do, because there are many things that we should be doing and many other things that we should not be doing. Sometimes if you neglect those things, it doesn't mean that your prayer is rendered null and void and it doesn't count, but you won't get the maximum reward of the prayer because you're not doing certain things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded you to do. Or you're doing things that he told you not to do. So one of the things that he commanded us to do and he prohibited us from leaving it alone is to take a sutra. And a sutra is that thing that the prayer puts in front of him to prevent other people from walking between him and his sutra. It can be a wall. It could be a human being. It could be a chair. It can be a pillar. It could be one of those brown things that you see back there. It could be one of these stands that they put the Quran on, It could be a microphone. It could be a stick. It can be an animal. Anything that's going to be stationary so that when people see you praying in front of that thing, then they know they have to respect that distance because that's your distance between you and Allah. It's not permissible for any Bani Adam to come between you and that distance. It is your place and only your place. No one else. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he mentioned, Rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi arba'un min al-jafa. Four things are from al-jafa. Al-jafa means when you have a problem with someone. You and your mother, you and your father, you and your wife, you and your friend. There's some beef, some drama that exists between the two of you and you're apart. You're not talking, you're not communicating, you're split. He said four things are from al-jafa. The first one he mentioned, and yusalli al-rajul ila ghayri sutratan. For a man to pray to other than a sutra. A man shouldn't pray to other than a sutra. If he does, that's from al-jafat. The other three things that he mentioned is for him to urinate when he's standing up. If he doesn't have a reason to do that, it is not from the adab of al-Islam. It's not from the sunnah. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood up to urinate, but there was a reason why he did that. So if you have a reason, then no problem. But if you don't have a reason, you should always sit down when you urinate. Akramakumullah. He said also the third thing is for a person to hear the adhan and he doesn't go to the masjid. That's from al-jafat. And the fourth and final thing is to wipe his forehead. The meaning of wiping his forehead is after the prayer. After the prayer, the salaf, they used to dislike if you got dirt on your forehead to wipe your forehead until you got up and you went away. And that's because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith about Laylatul Qadr, he prayed with the people, the Salat of Al-Fajr, and it had rain all night. And the water from the rain seeped through the ceiling. So when he made sajda, he developed on his forehead the mark of the teen, of the mud. And he got up and he left it on his head. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and people from the Salaf were of the opinion, if you get dirt on your forehead as a result of praying, don't wipe it away until you get up and you go away. You get up from the prayer and you give salams and you go away, then wipe it. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he mentioned that not praying towards something to give you that haqq between you and Allah, the sutra, it is a type of jafa, and it should be avoided. As for the hadith of taking the sutra, there are many, many. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in what was collected by Imam Muslim, on the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu anhu, لا تصلي إلا إلى سترة ولا تدع أحدا يمر بين يديك. فَإِنْ أَبَى فَلْتُقَاتِلْهُ فَإِنْ مَعْهُ قَرِينٌ. He said, do not, prohibition. He said, do not pray except towards a sutra. And don't let anyone walk in front of you and your sutra. And if someone insists and he tries to walk in front of you and in front of your sutra, then you should stop him. So that is a hadith that prohibits. Another hadith, and there are many, it's a hadith that commands Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, radiallahu anhu, what was collected by Imam Abu Dawood. He said that the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا صَلَّ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيُصَلِّ إِلَى سُتْرَةً وَلَا يَدْعَ أَحَدًا يُمُرُّ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَهُ فَإِنْ أَبَى فَلْيُقَاتِلْهُ فَإِنَّهُ الشَّيْطَانِ. He said, if any of you prays, then you must pray towards a sutra. And don't let anyone walk between you and the sutra. And if someone tries, if someone really tries, then you should fight him because he is a shaitan. So some of the ulama, because of these two hadith, they took the position that the sutra was wajib, that you have to do it, like Al-Imam Ahmed and Al-Imam Shawkani and other than them. But I want to say to you, those of you who are trying to be on the sunnah, and it's all of us, you have to relax in these issues. You have to relax in these issues. Don't be a mutashaddid. You see some people, and they're from the Hanafi madhab, from our relatives, or a masjid that you go into, and they don't want to put their feet next to you, and these individuals don't believe in taking a sutra. For an example, people that are not taking a sutra, don't be mutashaddid, because there are some scholars who took the position that it's not wajib, because there are some hadith where it says that the Prophet ﷺ prayed to other than a sutra, to other than a wall. He prayed to other than a wall. Okay, many of you prayed today to other than a wall, but that didn't negate that you had a sutra. So the point here is, there are some scholars who said it is mustahab and it's the sunnah. So don't be rough and don't be tough with people when it comes to practicing and applying the sunnah. Especially if you know the issue has ikhtilaf. If you know, then be a tolerant person who tries to relay the haqq and the truth and knowledge to others. And don't be judgmental towards others and rough and tough with them because they didn't take your point of view. And a lot of times, the people have an opinion that is supported by scholars. So take it easy. I believe, wallahi, by the Lord of the Kaaba, that you're sinning if you don't pray towards a sutra, because he commanded you must do it and he prohibited you from doing it. And the principle in Usul al-Fiqh is Al-Amr yafidu al-wajub illa an ya'tiya sarifun fayusrifu an al-wajub. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commands you to do something, it is wajib to do that thing, unless something comes to show you it's not wajib. He said in the hadith, Allah has added a prayer on you people, and it is the witr prayer. So pray the witr. So he commanded. In another hadith, he said, verily Allah, he has made witr wajib. So whoever doesn't make witr is not from us. Whoever doesn't make witr is not from us. Man la yutir falaysa minna. So he commanded. But there's a hadith that came where he said, five prayers you have to do in a day and a night. So that goes to show it's not wajib al-witr. The man came and said, Ya Rasulullah, if I pray my five prayers and I fast Ramadan, will I go to Jannah? You say, yeah. So if witr was wajib, if Eid was wajib, he would have said other than that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there are many hadith ordering, take the sutra. And there are hadith, like the one I mentioned, prohibiting you from praying without a sutra. As Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, and this principle comes from the Quran and the Sunnah, the opposite one of the first one that I mentioned. An-nahyu yafidul tahrim illa an ya'tiya sarifun fayusrifu anhu. When there's a prohibition, it means that it is haram. Unless a dalil comes to show, no, this is not haram, it's makruh. Like the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, inni akrahu al-kay. Inni akrahu al-kay. He said, I hate cauterization, when you burn yourself to get the disease out. He allowed it. He told the people he allowed it, but he said, I don't like it. So it shows it's not haram because he allowed it. He allowed his companions to do it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his speech allowed it. So the ayat of the Quran is said, فَلْيَحْذِرَ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبُهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ أَوْ يُصِيبُهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Let those people beware who go against his command, that a fitna will hit them or they'll get another severe punishment. Or the other ayat, وَمَا آتَاكُمْ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوا وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. What the Prophet told you to do, do it. And what he prohibited you from, leave it all alone. مَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ وَمَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ. What I told you to do, do whatever, as much of it as you can do. And you have the ability to take the sutra. It's wajib. And what I told you don't do, leave all of that alone. So he prohibited us and told us, don't pray without taking a sutra. So those two hadith, ikhwani, we're going to naktafi bihima. We're going to just use those two, but they're mini hadith, but they're repetitive. They're saying the same thing. We move on to the issue of the way that the companions used to look at this issue of taking the sutra and the emphasis that they used to put on it. Ridwanullahi alayhim. Like the statement that Al-Imam al-Bukhari brought, Rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. There was a companion, his name is Qurra ibn Iyas. May Allah be pleased with him. He said, I was praying between two pillars, and I didn't have a sutra, and Umar came, and he grabbed me by the back of my neck, and he pulled me over and put me behind a sutra, and then he told me while I was praying, Salli ilayha, pray towards this. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he was Amir bin Ma'ruf, Nahiun an al-Munkar. He used to command the good, and used to prohibit the evil. And he was waqafun li kitabillah. And whenever you gave him a dalil, anytime you went against his position and you said, Allah said this, Rasulullah said that, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, even if someone did something bad to him and he was angry, if you gave him the dalil, he was stop. Waqaf li Quran. That's a tremendous characteristic to have. To be a person, when the proof comes to you, you submit tanqad ila al-haq wa ila al-dalil. And that's something that's hard to do for a lot of people. His wife comes and says to him, this thing you're doing in the deen or the dunya is wrong because Allah said, Rasulullah said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then his kibr makes him say, what scholar said that before you? And he knows what she's saying is right. He knows what she's saying is right, but he just can't take the advice. So he says, what scholar said that before you? Knowing full well it's going to be hard for her to say which scholar. She just heard a hadith here. She knows an ayat there. So the point is, don't be from those people. Don't be from those people. Umar radiallahu anhu, he saw the need and the importance and the significance when he saw the Muslim praying, his brother from the companions, he was praying without a sutra. He put him, radiallahu anhu, behind the sutra. That's an example. Another example is what was collected by Imam al-Bukhari on the authority of Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu. And Anas ibn Malik was asked the question, can you pray after the adhan of al-Maghrib and before the salat? Is there a sunnah prayer, two rakat, before the adhan, after the adhan of al-Maghrib and before the Maghrib prayer? In many masjids, after the adhan of Maghrib, immediately they make the iqama. And although this is permissible, it's in contradiction of the sunnah. And when you do that, and when the masjid does that, you are helping to destroy and to kill and to eliminate a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there's no wisdom in doing that. People are fasting on Mondays and Thursdays. They are fasting in other days. So what is the wisdom? What is the hikmah? What is the illah? What is the sabab? Why? Why do that? Give the people time to pray two rakat. And what was collected by Al-Imam Muslim, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Baina al-adhanain aw kulli al-adhanain salatun. Between every adhan and iqama, there is a prayer to be made. Sunnah. So every adhan, five times a day, and every iqama after that adhan, five times a day, there are two rakats to be prayed, even after Maghrib. So they wanted to know from Anas ibn Malik, can you pray these two rakats after the adhan of Maghrib and before the iqama? He said, لَقَدْ كُنْتُ رَأَيْتُ أَصْحَابَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَبْتَدِرُونَ السَّوَارِ بَعْدَ الْمَغْرِبِ حتى يخرج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, I saw the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم taking the pillars of the masjids as sutra. They used to take the pillars and get behind the pillars, and they used to pray two rakats after the adhan of Maghrib, and then they would wait till the Prophet came out صلى الله عليه وسلم. So his mentioning the sutra issue was a secondary issue. He just wanted to let them know, we used to pray after Maghrib, but how did we pray? We used to pray behind the pillars, taking the sutra. Another one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his name is Salama ibn al-Aqwa, may Allah be pleased with him, if he traveled and he was in the desert, al-Bariya, he would take rocks and put those rocks on top of each other if he didn't find a sutra, and he would pray towards those rocks in the middle of the desert. And that was the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the middle of the desert, there's nothing around, no trees, nothing, nothing's around. What would he do? He would take his spear, he would put it in the earth, and he would use it as a sutra, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He would make his camel sit down, and then he would use his camel as a sutra, knowing that the camel more than likely wasn't going to get up, wasn't going to walk away, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wasallam. One of the salaf from the tabi'een, his name is Nafi', al-Imam Nafi', al-Imam Malik, narrates the hadith from Nafi'. Nafi' narrates the hadith from Abdullah ibn Umar. And the scholars call this chain of narration Al-Silsilatul Dhahabiyya, the golden chain of narration. They said the best chain of narration in Ilm al-Hadith is when Al-Imam Malik narrates that he heard from his sheikh from the tabi'een, Nafi'. Nafi' said he heard from Abdullah ibn Umar. May Allah be pleased with him. Abdullah ibn Umar said he heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this and this and that and this. Nafi' said, if I was with Abdullah ibn Umar and we were together and he didn't find anything to turn into a sutra, he would say to me, to Nafi', wallini dhahrak, turn your back to me and sit down and let me pray and you be my sutra. Just like his father used to do. Abdullah ibn Umar's father is Umar, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. It was reported, ruwiya an Humayd ibn Hilal, it was narrated that Umar radiallahu anhu saw a man praying and people were walking in front of him. They were walking in front of him while he was praying because he didn't have a sutra. So Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, went to that man and put his back to that man and sat down, face the Qibla, so that he could be the sutra to the man. So the adab, if you're going to pray and a human being is going to be your sutra, is that you should try to have their back to you as opposed to praying and they're looking at you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray in his house, and our mother Aisha used to be sleeping, lying down, and she was in front of him. And when he wanted to make sajda, he would bow down and touch her feet. She would pull her feet in, and he was praying towards her, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he wasn't praying to her. So that goes to show us the importance of the hadith, innama al-a'malu bin-niyat. The deeds will be judged by your actions. So the qibla in your house is facing the fireplace. We don't pray towards no fire. If you can help it, don't pray towards the fire. The fire is burning. And you say, it's not my niyyah. No, it's better for you not to do that. It's better for you not to pray towards fire. مَن تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Whoever resembles and he imitates a people, he's like that. So the people worship the fire, they pray towards the fire. So you have to make an effort not to pray towards the fire. But if you don't have any other alternative except to pray in that room and that fire is facing the Qibla, and that's the only thing and the only way you can pray at your work, at home, wherever you may happen to be, then innama al-a'malu bin-niyyat. But you have to make an effort not to do that, not to do that. And some of the people of the past, they used to, like Burra, he said that his father, that he was told that when he saw the people praying without a sutra, he said that these people, their children are going to come and they're going to say, inna wajadna aba'ana ala ummatin wa inna lahum muqtadun. Verily found our fathers doing this and we're going to follow what our fathers were doing. When we allow these types of sunan to die, to disappear, to dissipate, then the new revert who comes, he's not going to know. He's not going to know. Our children are not going to know. They're not going to know. So everybody has a responsibility to do his best to, inshallah, give life to sunan that have been forgotten, that have died, sunan that the people don't know about. And again, I repeat what I told you people before. We're not perfect here in Green Lane. We're not perfect. And we all know that we could be better people, better Muslims. We could have memorized more of the Quran had we been more committed. We could have had 40 hadith committed to memory by now. But we're not perfect. But you leave Birmingham and you go to some of these masajid across the UK where the Muslims don't have a clue. They don't have a clue about the etiquette of the masjid. They don't have a clue about respect and knowledge, the importance of the sunnah. They don't have a clue as to how the Muslim woman should dress. So she's outside without any hijab. But alhamdulillah, she has iman. So she comes to the masjid. What does the masjid do? The masjid facilitates for her a hijab. Some of our wives wear that hijab. It looks like a little Martian suit. The head part is a little Martian-like, but the bottom part is wide. Our wives wear that. Don't look at me like I'm the only one who's saying that. Our wives wear that. They have in the masjid a bunch of those. So when the lady comes in with no hijab on, she puts that on, and then she prays, and then she takes it off, and she goes out. And I don't know. Is that masjid facilitating masiya? Because if you do that, you're saying it's okay. But if you take it away and she comes, she can't pray. So it's one of those catch-22s. It's dichotomy. So the point here is these issues about holding on to every aspect of al-Islam, of course, prioritizing things, holding on to at-tawheed, holding on to the correct aqidah. The issue of whatever sunnah you have the ability to keep alive, then keep it alive. The sunnah of the nawafil prayer. The sunnah of Thursdays and Mondays fasting. The sunnah of so many issues, the du'as that we should know, coming in the masjid, going out of the masjid, and so forth and so on. So the salaf of this ummah, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they used to be shadeed. Or not shadeed in a negative way, mutamassikun, holding on to the sunan of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look what happened, ikhwani, look what happened. A man from the tabi'een, his name is Busr ibn Sa'id. He said, Busr ibn Sa'id from the tabi'een. He said, I was sent by a companion. The companion's name is Zayd ibn Khalid. Busr said, Zayd ibn Khalid sent me to Abu Juhaym, another companion. That companion sends the younger tabi'i to go to the other companion, Abu Juhaym. Abu Juhaym is Abdullah ibn Harith al-Ansari, radiallahu anhu. Say, hey, you go over to him and ask him, what does he know about walking in front of the person who was praying? What did he hear about that from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So Busr went, Abu Juhaym, he said, listen, Zayd ibn Khalid, radiallahu anhu, sent me to, he wants to know, what did you hear that the Prophet said about this issue, sallallahu alayhi wasallam? He said, I heard the Prophet say, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, لو يعلم النار بين يدي المصلي لكان له أن يقف أربعين خير له من أن يمر بين يديه. The one who is walking in front of a person who is praying, if he knew the evil of that, if he knew the sin of that, if he knew the danger of walking in front of someone with a sutra, then it would have been better for him to wait for 40. One of the narrators in the hadith said, I don't know if he said 40 days. I don't know if he said 40 months. I don't know if he said he should wait 40 years. And that is a nahy, a nahyul al-akid. A nahyul al-akid wal-wa'id al-shadid. That's a serious issue. Before walking in front of someone, you should wait 40. Don't throw the dice and gamble and say 40 seconds. I think that's what it's talking about. 40 minutes. No, you need to just wait. Go around or go the other way. This hadith had a reason too, why he said that. The companion, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, was praying, radiallahu anhu. And a young man wanted to leave the masjid. And the only way that he can get out of the masjid was passing in front of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. I don't know. Maybe Abu Sa'id al-Khudri was praying right there, right here. And that's the only way to get out of that side of the masjid where he was. He couldn't go around. He had to go that way. So he tried to get across in front of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri pushed him back in his chest. He didn't know what to do. He has to get out. So he got upset and he went to force himself. And then Abu Sa'id al-Khudri pushed him very hard. And he got upset. And he said something negative to Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. He's from the Tabi'een. And he has su' al-adab with the sheikh, with the elder, from the companions, radiallahu anhum. Because we're human beings and that can happen. So we don't endorse, nor do we condone having bad adab with people older than you, even if they're non-Muslims. And we don't condone and we don't endorse you having bad adab with people of knowledge. But it happens. So if you see it happening with someone, relax, take it easy. It happened with people better than that individual. And plus, he doesn't have a pattern of doing that. Relax yourself. Become angry for Allah, but be angry for the right thing and in the right way. Don't always be angry. I saw Abu Suhaib's talk, the last one, in which he was given those things he would mention from the Jawami' al-Kalim. And he mentioned some things, and I didn't listen to the whole lecture. But I happened to look at one of the comments, and someone didn't agree with something that he said in the dars. I never heard what he said, but I read the comment. The person said, because he said whatever he said in the dars, he's a traitor, a munafiq. Because he disagrees with you, he becomes a munafiq? This is how we are. And that's the culture of the social media. Everyone is a jackleg sheikh. Everyone has an opinion and say what he wants. And it's insanity because our comments always go south. They always go pear shaped. Just have edit and put your opinion. We are some nasty pieces of work, the Muslims. We'll take people outside of Islam. We'll talk about their mothers. We'll use those nasty curse words just because he didn't agree with you. And the haq may be with him. So I want to ask you people, billahi alik, when you wash your baby in that little basin or whatever, you wash him in the dirty water, do you take the baby and the water and you throw it out in the backyard? Does anybody do that? Because I'll call social services on you. Does anybody do that? No one does that. We're going to wash that baby and take him over there and then discard the dirty water. Any of you, when you cut your fingernails, do you cut your whole finger off? Cutting a fingernail? I know some of you bite way down into the cuticle. You're muta nervous. I know that. Stop doing that. And I know some of you cut all the way down till you get to the meat. But does anybody here cut his whole finger off? Anybody? Okay. Well, your brother took a position. The sheikh took a position different from your position. Relax yourself, ya akhi. Be more tolerant. Am I encouraging you, educating you, calling you to be tolerant to what's haram, shirk, kufr, bid'ah, homosexuality, all of this stuff? No. I'm saying know your environment and know what's going on and know who you're dealing with. We want the sunnah to spread. A lot of times, the spread of the truth comes with good teaching, good preaching, and people doing it the right way, doing it themselves, being examples. So that hadith, the young boy went to the Khalifa at that time. His name was Marwan ibn Hakim. He went to complain, and he complained, and he said what happened. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri went behind him and came in. The Amir al-Mu'mineen said, "What's wrong with you and the son of my brother, my nephew? What happened?" He told him the story, and he told him, "I heard the Prophet say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if the one who's going to pass in front of someone who's praying knew the evil of it, he will wait for 40. He will wait for 40. And he told him the hadith of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, don't let anyone pass in front of you while you're making a salat. Don't let him pass in front of you in your sutra. And if he really tries, then you can fight him." Now, the word that was used was muqatila, kill him, fight him. But that doesn't mean you take out a knife and you stab him. It doesn't mean that's extreme. That doesn't mean you take out a pen and you put it in his eye. It doesn't mean that. doesn't mean that you grab him and you go extreme. It means you can use force. So you stop him at first, he insists. You can do it stronger. Yeah, you're praying, and you're going to let him know. You know who you're dealing with right now. And you use that strength, and you're going to let him know. I'm not joking with you, and you're still praying. Now, in the fiqh of Islam, there is a thing that's called the diya. The diya is when you're responsible for knocking someone's eye out. You're responsible for cracking his head open. You're responsible for breaking his finger, chopping his finger off. La samah Allah. You were responsible for his lihya getting taken off. You broke his foot. You, your family, your child. Your wife opened the window. She wanted to look out the window. And the pot fell. And it smashed someone's car, his window. You have to pay for that. The itlaf, the destruction of people's property. You have a camel, or sheep, something, and he goes into the yard of someone, into his mazra, and he eats his vegetation, his fruit. You have to pay for that. The scholars of Islam said, in the process of stopping someone from passing in front of you, if he accidentally fell and he cracked his head, he accidentally got tangled up and he cracked his hip, something happened to him and he broke something. Because of your force, there's no diya upon you. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if he insists, then use more force. So with that being the case, make things easy for you, easy for people. If the people see that you have a sutra, then the people know I can walk in front of him. I can walk in front of the sutra. And if a person doesn't have the sutra, try to walk behind the individual. Because some of the ulama of the opinion, even if he has a sutra, you shouldn't walk in front of him. But the strong opinion, inshallah, is that you're allowed to walk in front of him, sutra, but you can't walk between him and between his sutra. Another issue about the sutra is, Khani, is that the Prophet ﷺ said to the person who takes a sutra, وَلِيَدْنُ مِنْهَا, let him come close to it. So don't let your sutra, you're praying here, and you think that your sutra is all the way over there, 5 meters, 10 meters. No. When the Prophet made sajda, and his head hit the ground in prostration, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Between his head and the sutra was enough space for a small animal to walk through it. So the space shouldn't be like that, nor should your head be right up on the sutra, but it should just be enough where a small animal can walk through it. Again, stay balanced. No one is telling you to go bring a small animal and then you measure it and you do. Don't do that. That's too much. Relax, because there are people who are like that. And that's why the Prophet said, halakal mutanatti'un. Those people go too deep, they will be destroyed. And I've seen this. I told you about the sisters with the hijab in certain masjids. There are certain masjids with hats, topis, the kufis. They got hats, a basket of hats. So if you go in that masjid and you don't get that hat and put it on, people get upset with you. No, man, I'm not putting on anybody else's hat. Because I don't know who got the ringworms, and I don't know who got lice in his head, and I don't know who's hygienic and who's not hygienic. So you've seen sometimes I've given the khutbah and I had to borrow someone's hat. When I'm looking to borrow someone's hat, I'm looking in the audience at someone who I say, yeah, that guy, he looks like he knows the hadith, at-tuhur, shatr al-iman. Cleanliness is half of faith. So I say, let me use your hat. But if I didn't find anyone, I felt like I'd just leave the issue. Although you don't have to pray with a hat. So the one who feels you must pray with a hat. You must. He'll put pressure on you praying with the hat. And there's no hadith ordering it. No hadith prohibiting you from not doing it. He'll put pressure on you and he shadid on it. But he won't put his foot next to you in the prayer. And there are texts telling him to do that. He won't take a sutra. And that's how the time is that we're living in. The sunnah is innovation. Innovation is the sunnah. And with that being the case, being equipped with that knowledge and that information, take it easy. Take it easy and give in da'wah to Allah. Be rough and tough with the imams of kufr. Be rough and tough with the people who deserve that. But generally speaking, try to be hayyin layyin basita. Be easygoing. Be gentle. Be relaxed with the people that you're giving da'wah to. So there's a lot of fiqh Ikhwani, concerning the issue of the sutra and the issue of those sunan that are mahjura, the sunan that the people don't do or they don't know about. They don't do, they don't know about. Try to be of those people, not who are trying to be gharib. You want to be gharib, strange, and you're doing everything that people, no, don't try to be like that. But when you know that something is from the sunnah, then do it. Like those imams of the past. They used to say, if I knew something was the sunnah, I would do it at least once in my life. Once I know it's a sunnah, I'm going to do it. One of the scholars, I don't remember who it was off the top of my head, he said, if I believed going on top of a mountain and secluded myself in i'tikaf was the sunnah, I would do it. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go to Mount Hira before the Quran came to him, and he was contemplating, concentrating, meditating, doing whatever he was doing up there. He said, if that was the sunnah, I would do that as well. And like that hadith that we just mentioned, that companion, radiallahu anhu, he sent Busr to go to the other companion because he wanted to know, what did you hear from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about this issue? And one of them would travel a long distance just to get one hadith. So let us, inshallah, you younger brothers especially, use this time of good health and youthful exuberance to memorize the Quran. Ibrahim, Ismail, all of you young guys, all of you brothers, this is the time for you guys to get serious in terms of memorizing, especially memorizing. And stop messing about, stop mucking about. Just get serious with the minhaj so that inshallah after a year, 2, 3 years, you're going to be far advanced from where you are right now. So we'll take any questions that you may have for the next 10 minutes. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you the khair of the dunya and the akhirah. Abu Ismail, when are you coming to visit me up there, man? Yes. All right, we're waiting for you, inshallah. Huh? Hey, that's the spot, man. Any questions, Ikhwani? Naam, akhi. If a person walks in front of the person who doesn't have a sutra, is his salat rendered null and void? Allahumma la. But he's sinning. It's not null and void. It's not batila. But he's sinning. But if one of three things passes in front of him and he doesn't have a sutra, then yes, his salat is batila with some of the ulama because of an authentic hadith. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, anyone who's praying and a black dog walks in front of him, it nullifies his prayer. Or a woman who is on her period, it nullifies her prayer. It nullifies the salat of the praying person. And the third one, I believe, is a donkey. I believe. But I'm not sure. I'm in doubt. So I will have to go back and I will have to find that. Akhi Nuruddin, find that real quick for me in the what's up. Ask what's up about those three things. I'm sure about those two. The woman who is on her period. As for the one who's not on her period, I told you Prophet Muhammad was praying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aisha was in front of him. He used to touch her and she would pull in her legs. It goes to show, touching a woman while you have wudu doesn't break your wudu. And touching a woman while you're praying, it doesn't invalidate your prayer. Unless she's on her menses. Akramakumullah. Akramakumullah. Naam, akhi. Good question, akhi. Concerning Mecca and Mukarrama. Can you pray there without the sutra? The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the ayat of the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are general. They're for everybody, they're for every time, they're for every place, unless there's a dalil showing there's an exception. So, as it relates to taking a sutra, Mecca has the same ruling. Medina has the same ruling, although there's a lot of zahma, a lot of crowds that are there. So what you have to do when you're there is, you get in where you fit in. Try to get in a place, and it's doable, it's possible. Get in a place where you can do it behind the pillar, where you can do it behind people who are praying. But if someone was trying to pray, someone was trying to pray where the people walk around the Kaaba, you can't pray there. You can't pray there because people are going to run in front of you and walk in front of you. So try to get in a place where it's most suitable for you. In Mecca, you're going to pray sometimes right next to a woman. She's going to be right next to you because that happens. There's so many people. And in these cases, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ لَا يُكَلِّفُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا وُسْعَهَا نَعْمْ أَخِي نُورَ الدِّينِ. A donkey, huh? Can a telephone be the sutra? So the hadith said three things. If it walks in front of you, it breaks your salah. You got to start praying again. The woman who's on her period. The woman who's on her period, the donkey and the black dog. So if a white dog comes by, a brown dog comes by, just keep it moving. Keep it moving. No problem. Keep it moving. You don't want to touch him. He's a dog. You're praying. Just let him go by. But the black dog, you have to start your prayer over. They say, what's wrong with the black dog? Why the black dog? He said, it is a shaitan. Another hadith said, with him is a shaitan. There's a shaitan who's with him. So now the question is, some people take their mobile phones and they put it on the floor as being the sutra. Some people take their hat and they put it on the floor as being a sutra. They take their pen, put it on the floor, being a sutra. The wallet, his book, is that a sutra? Allahumma la. That's not the sutra, because the Prophet ﷺ gave the size of the sutra, and he said it should be the size, the height of your saddle, your riding saddle on the horse, the riding saddle that's on the camel, and that riding saddle has that thing in the front and in the back, and it's about this high. Again, don't go overboard. You don't have to go and get a saddle, and you have to measure it. And you know, you say my sutra has to be so many centimeters. You don't have to do that. Relax, akhi. Relax, take it easy. At-tashaddud is not nice in the religion. At-tashaddud, being rough and tough with my wife, with my kids, with the people, with myself. La. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. Allah mentioned in the Quran, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لَكُمَ الْيُسْرِ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمَ الْعُسْرِ. He said in the Quran, فَإِنَّمَا الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا إِنَّمَا الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. He said in the Quran, وَمَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى. Islam wants to make things easy for you. So no, your phone and things like that are still on the ground, not permissible. Also, there are some ahadith that says take a sutra even if you have to make a line in the earth. You have to make a line. These hadith are not authentic because people can't really see that. They can't appreciate that. But they can see something that's big, and they'll have respect, even the kuffar to this day in America. If you have been sentenced to death, the death penalty. In certain states in America, there's the death penalty right now. And in that death penalty, before you get killed with electricity, lethal injection, they shoot you, hang you, whatever they do, they give you some last requests. One of the last requests is, what's your religion? I'm a Muslim. I'm a Jew. I'm a Christian. Okay, we're going to bring your preacher in, your priest, your imam. He's going to make dua for you, whatever. Give you support. What's the last thing that you want to eat? Your last meal. So depending upon what's your favorite food, they're going to bring that. Whatever it happens to be. So I know what some of you are going to choose because of your cultures. People are going to say the same thing. And then they say to you, you can make your last prayer. And they'll give you time to pray your last prayer. And as long as you want to take, they'll give you that time. Even if you tried to pray for a whole day, they know at some point you're going to get tired. And once you start praying, they don't bother you. They don't interrupt you. They have respect for the spectacle of death in their constitution. So the constitution has some good things, has some bad things. Again, it's a dichotomy. It's an enigma, something hard to understand. On one point, You have rights that are protected. The government, the Constitution would allow you to march. It would allow you to march and protest against the government. And they will protect you in doing that. They will protect you to say, we don't want you. But that same Constitution would allow the criminal who became the president to become the president. How does that happen? Where he loses the general vote, he loses, but he wins. Because of the ayahs of the Quran. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمَ الظَّالِمُونَ. The hukum of Allah is the best hukum. It's the most just hukum. It's the most beneficial hukum. إِلَىٰ آخِرِهِ. So as it relates to this issue, if the non-Muslims, ikhwani, have respect for people who are praying, then مِنْ بَابِ الْأَوْلَىٰ, the Muslim, we should respect people who are praying. But we don't have that respect because after the prayer, in many masajid, after the prayer, you will hear the people talking. You will hear doing the prayer, the mobile phones going off. But after the prayer, there's a hadith where he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna al-mala'ikata tusalli ala ahidikum ma dama fi musallahu alladhi salla fihi ma lam yahdith. The mala'ika will continue to make dua for you as long as you sat in the place where you prayed. The malaika will keep asking Allah for dua for you as long as you don't lose your wudu. So after prayer, the people were sitting in their places. The malaika still making dua. And these people over here screaming and shouting and hollering because they don't have respect. They don't have respect. How does that respect come? By people like you. You, and me giving advice and not feeling I'm just coming to be a taker. I'm coming to benefit. Don't be like that. You have to be like that water that the Prophet mentioned, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, مَثَلِي وَمَثَلُ مَا بَعَثَنِ اللَّهِ بِهِ مِنَ الْهُدَىٰ كَمَثَلِ الْغَيْثِ أَصَابَ أَرْضًا. He said, my example, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my sunnah, my religion, my example, and what Allah sent me with of guidance and knowledge is like the example of the rain that came down and hit the ground. There are three categories of people, three types of land. He said the first type of land, the rain came down, the land soaked it in, and then it threw out its vegetation. So he took the information, he took, and then he gave back with dawah, with practicing, with nasiha. He said the second type of land is that the rain came down and it brought in the rain. The land brought in the rain, but it didn't send anything out. Like the desert, the sand doesn't send anything out. There's some dirt. Nothing grows there. But it benefited. It took the knowledge. It took the rain. And some people are like that. I'm going to listen to the khutbah. I listen to the dars, but I ain't got nothing to say. I ain't saying nothing. I'm not saying anything. I don't care if I see someone getting ready to do something, shirk. I don't have anything to say. Nafsi. And then the third type of person is like the land that the rain came down and it just settled on top of the land, became a puddle. The land didn't take it in and it didn't send it out. He didn't get any benefit. He's like the one who turned away. وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ ذُكِّرَ بِآيَاتِنَا فَأَعْرَضَ عَنْهَا إِنَّا مِنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ لَمُنْتَقِمُونَ. Who is worse than the one who is reminded and he turns away? He turns away. He didn't get any benefit. Allah said, we're going to take revenge from these criminals who do that. All of those ayat. So anyway, ikhwani, this is how we're going to spread the sunnah. And this is how, inshallah ta'ala, the sunnah is going to live and it's going to be revived. Tafadhali ya akhi. Now, I have been to Mecca when there's a lot of zahma, and there's a book that one of the sheikhs of the haram, he put out. I think it's a Sheikh al-Shuraim. I'm pretty sure it's him. And his book is called Ahkam al-Zahma. the rules and regulations that come as a result of big crowds, big crowds. And he brings a lot of amazing contemporary issues. When you're in Mecca at Hajj time and the rolls extend all the way back to your hotel and beyond your hotel, is it permissible for you to leave the ninth floor where you're staying and just come down in the musalla of that hotel and don't even go outside and pray with the jama'at? He brings all of these new issues. And from the issues he's bringing from the rules and regulations of Zahma is when you see in Mecca all of these people, what do? You have to try your best to just avoid them. Try your best to imagine where the sutra would be and try to get through them. Try your best to wait a little time for the people to clear out and so forth and so on. You just try your best. And in concluding, I want to mention something personal to you, brothers, to let you know that I understand your youthful exuberance and being rough and tough when you're young. And as you get older and older, you calm down. You see some of these older brothers here? You're not like you were when you were 18, 19, and 20. I remember when I was in Medina, and I was about 22 years old. When I learned about the Rafida, the Shiite of Iran and Iraq who cursed the companions, I developed a real unhealthy hatred for them. Very unhealthy, because you shouldn't hate people to that degree. Hate what they're saying, hate that aqidah, hate that minhaj, hate the ulama who came up with that stuff. But hating each and every individual, I used to have a very unhealthy hatred for them, to the point where I would walk in front of them when they were praying. They would be praying, I'd just walk right by them and I wouldn't care. Just keep walking. Because I didn't see them as being Muslims and I didn't see that they had the right to even be there because of what they were saying about Aisha, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and his companions, Abu Bakr and Umar in particular. So I would walk in front of them. And I thought I was justified in doing so. And we used to do other things other than that. It was unhealthy. But as time went on, you start growing, you start developing, you start realizing these people are ignorant and they don't know what they're doing. And it's not so much that person who's praying, it's the fact of a salat. Respect the salat. It's like the spectacle of death. A janazah went by, Prophet Muhammad stood up, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The companions say, Ya Rasulullah, it's the janazah of a non-Muslim. He said, is he not dead? It's a dead person. It's the spectacle of death. It's not the kufr that I'm respecting. It's this serious issue of kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. This spectacle of death has to be respected, whether it's a Muslim or a non-Muslim. So he told the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَقَدْ كُنْتُ نَهَيْتُكُمْ مِنْ زِيَارَةِ الْقُبُورِ فَزُرُوهَا فَإِنَّهَا تُذَكِّرُكُمْ بِالْآخِرَةِ. I used to order you people, prevent you from going to the graves, but I'm telling you, go to the graves, they will remind you of the hereafter. And he didn't say go to the Muslim grave, he said go to the graves. So if you go to a grave where they're non-Muslims, just so that you can think and reflect, I don't care how nice your house look. I saw that in a text message today, WhatsApp. Someone had a bedroom, had a very nice queen size bed, matching lamps on either side, matching dresser drawers, a chest, nice carpet. That was the room. You're looking at the room from here. And at the foot of the bed was a hole of the grave. I thought that was a nice picture. That I don't care how nice your house is, how nice your car is, this is where we're going to end up, in that grave ultimately. So we have to do everything to make that grave and the reality, that's the end result, make it something that sticks in the front of your eyes so that we don't make ghibah and slip, so that we don't make namima and slip, so that we don't waste time and we slip and we forget. Okay, ikhwani, may Allah bless you, brothers, inshallah, make things easy for all of you. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا وعلى آله وأصحابه السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.